the campaign video that you saw gave you a sense of the overarching goals of the campaign and of the statewide nature of the jail crisis. Just to repeat a statistic that you heard on the video, there are 25,000 people in jail in New York State on any given day. So multiply that out, both by the people who are in jail in 3 weeks from now, but also by their families and their communities. It is a tremendous number of people. Of that 25,000, 67% are pretrial. 67% are legally innocent, have not been convicted. So we are talking about something that is both a violation of the bedrock of our justice system, that you are innocent until proven guilty, but that also has unbelievable consequences for people's lives. That it doesn't take 2.5 years, as Khalif Browder sat in jail, for you to lose your job, your apartment, your kids, your financial aid if you're in school. So we wanna talk about both what the policy issues are, but also what that actually means for people's lives, what it means for our communities and our families. And we want to talk about what that looks like here in Monroe County, in Rochester, in the surrounding areas, that this has real impact here. On any given day in Monroe County, there are about 1,300 people in jail. The county is jailing 1,300 people a day. 58% are pretrial, legally innocent. And so that is the context. I just wanted to set a little bit of the stage for our panel. So before we begin, let me introduce our panelists. So starting on the far end, we've got Ricardo Adams, who has lived in Rochester for 62 years and counting, and is a community advocate who wears many hats, including working at the Flying Squirrel, speaking at schools, speaking at colleges, is a pretty consistent presence as far as I can tell. To Ricardo's right is Caitlin Drojak, who is the proud mother of a 7-year-old who is proudly in recovery and who is gonna speak powerfully about her story. Next we have Josie Powers, who works for the Women's Initiative Supporting Health Program, supporting women who are coming home from jail and prison. Then we've got Natalie Knott, who is a public defender in Monroe County and so sees the system from that point of view. And then we've got Craig McNair, who is the executive director of the Pretrial Services Agency in Monroe County, as well as the president of the Association of Pretrial Services. So it's a good panel. So Ricardo, will you start? I want to start us off by thinking about what mass incarceration looks like in Monroe County and the impact for communities. We've got 1,300 people in jail every day in Monroe County alone over the course of a year. We're talking about thousands and thousands of people. What impact does this system of mass jail incarceration have on individuals and communities?
Well,
we only have one microphone.
Even though they won't say it, it's a crisis. It's been a crisis, just like the opioid crisis. The mass incarceration is a crisis that's been ongoing that nobody talks about. There's a lot of racial imbalance in there. The bail system is set up in a way that me as a black man, my bail is going to be higher than my white counterpart, way higher. In fact, odds are my white counterpart is going to get out on pretrial or something, so that any money that he has to use, he'll be able to use that on getting a lawyer. I don't have that advantage. First of all, the bail is going to be too high, so I ain't going to be able to make that. But I'm hoping that it's going to get cut down, so maybe I can get a bail if I don't have to pay for a lawyer. So I'm gonna go with the lawyer. I'm gonna be sitting in there for months and months. And if I stay in there long enough and I have to go to trial, I'm going to trial at a very disadvantage. The odds are I'm getting convicted, because everyone knows that a jury is influenced by what they see. That's the reason they allow you to wear your own civilian clothes to trial, because they know it's, the odds are against you of winning your case. But that doesn't make it better if that you have a suit on if you're still coming in there in handcuffs. It's, you're still going to end up losing. And in the situations where the DAs make these great deals for you, we're going to let you out now, you plead guilty, and we're going to let you out a couple months before you go to jail. They never let you plead under what's called the Alford Act. That's where you don't have to incriminate yourself. They make you say you're guilty, whether you're guilty or not. That's the only people I've seen allowed to use the Alford Act in Monroe County was like a fire chief that had got a crime, and one other person, I think, was a lawyer. But it was, wasn't nobody that looked it like me. The system is rigged against me. And I don't know of anybody that's has gone to trial within 6 months, a speedy trial. I don't know where that's applied. If you've gone to trial and you've made it there in 6 months, 9 out of 10, you ain't did no, your lawyer ain't did no discovery motions or nothing. So you're just, the system is rigged. And it's, we got to do something about it. You're talking about shutting down Rikers Island. We need to shut down Monroe County Jail.
Thanks, Ricardo. So just to point out to people a couple of the statistics that are on the screen behind you. 46% of the people in the Monroe County Jail are in on misdemeanor charges only. On average, people are spending 30 days in the jail. So if you think about your, imagine your life for a second, your apartment, your family, your school, your job, your benefits, your financial aid, and now imagine being disappeared from your life for 30 days. That you don't need to sit in jail for 2.5 years to lose all of that. So I want to turn it to Josie for a second. Josie, you work with women coming home from jail and prison. Will you talk a little bit about the effect that you see of people being incarcerated? What kinds of consequences that has for people?
Well, it's
you get a microphone.
To be perfectly honest, it's mind-boggling because
use the mic, please.
These women have lost all hope. I mean, they get bounced around in jail, they get disrespected, used and abused, and they're treated less than human. And I'm not saying that every CO is a bad CO, but there's enough of them to put the fear of God into most of these women. And they can't even go to the bathroom in peace without having some CO bounce in. Man on the floor, well, it's too late, you know? And in prison, you're constantly reminded that you're a ward of the state, you belong to the state, you have no say-so in anything that you do. When you're released, and I think this is what you're referring to, when you're released, you go from agency to agency to agency and try to get the help that you need. For housing is horrendous to try and find housing. Trying to find a job. Parole and probation gives you this long list of things that you have to comply with, but they don't give you any resources to get the job done. You know? My job in the WISH program, which is Women's Initiative Supporting Health, our main factor is health, because we want to make sure that these women coming home from jail who have not had the right medications, who have mental issues plus physical issues, and a lot of women that are in jail and they have mental health issues, they are not being treated because of the fact that what they have available for mental health in jail, especially Monroe County, is something that these women were not taking on the outside, and they know it won't work, so they would rather do without it than take anything at all. So my main function and my co-workers' function, the function of WISH, is to make sure these women get into mental health and get into physical health. And Dr. Morse, who I work under, refers them to wherever we go. Luckily, we're based at the University of Rochester, so we have many, many avenues open to these women. But they come in and they're all traumatized, and you sit there and you try to convince them, I'm here to help you. They don't believe me, you know, because they've been so turned away from so many different things. Yes, I can help you provided you do this. Yes, I can help you provided you do that. And one of the things is DSS. How are you going to release somebody from jail and have to wait 45 days before you get any money or any food stamps or Medicaid? You can get a state Medicaid card provided you have a mental deficiency of some sort. 90% of the time, they don't even get that card because they don't know they're entitled to it and nobody offers it to them. So they come out into this world where nothing is available to them. And a lot of times they get frustrated and then they end up back in jail because they had to go back to Lyle Avenue. They can't find their children. Their children have been traumatized. They've lost everything that they own. They can't find a place to live. It's horrendous. It is no joke, and I'm sure it's the same way for the men. It's a struggle for survival, and they have to survive any way they can. And a lot of times they end up back in jail because they're trying to survive. And that's the name. It's a vicious circle. You know, this guilty until proven innocent, I mean, innocent until proven guilty is what everybody says, but that's not true. It's guilty until proven innocent. And 9 times out of 10, you're sitting in jail and you try to prove your innocence. How are you going to do that if you're sitting in jail and you don't have the correct representation, you know? And I know that the Hispanics and the African Americans get a worse deal than we do, you know, than white folk. No, I'm not white, I'm Caucasian, but anyway. It's a total mess. It's a total mess, and the system needs to be changed, because why do we have our jails and our prisons full of innocent people? Why? Who can explain that to me? Who can say why these innocent people are sitting in jail, waiting for somebody to come and say, you're free. You didn't do it in the first place. That's 6 months into your life, and you've finally been told you didn't do it in the first place. Case dismissed. But what have you got to come home to? Nothing. You don't even know where your family is anymore. And if you do know where your family is, they don't want to be bothered with you because you're such a problem. You know, so I don't know. I don't know where this is going to take us. I don't know where we're going to go. I hope just this, us people getting together, will have some impact on this system, because the system is criminal, not the people it's locking up. The system itself is criminal, and we need to do something.
Thanks, Josie. So I'm going to point out one more. It's going to be my job to say numbers at you. I'm going to point out one more number, which is that across New York State in 2016, we spent $2.5 billion on county jails. $2.5 billion. That's an annual cost. In Monroe County, that's $71.5 million annually. It's an incredible amount of money. So it's useful to know also that we're making decisions as a county about how to allocate funds. Okay, so Natalie, we are talking here about bail, about speedy trial, and about discovery. And folks got a little bit of information from the video about what that means. But as somebody who practices the law, who's a public defender, will you just explain to us what is bail and what's the deal? What kinds of, what does that mean for people's lives? What's the deal with speedy trial and what's the deal with discovery?
Practice is the key word.
So bail. Most of us have an idea what bail is. It's supposed to be basically money you pay to a bail bondsman or to a court or that basically ensures you're going to return. How that's determined is typically at arraignment. So an arraignment is a person's first appearance on a criminal matter. It's where they enter their plea of not guilty, which reserves all of their rights. Their attorney will get their paper, the police reports, essentially, the very basic police reports, we call them accusatories. charging them with a crime, and then we get to the part that's called a bail application. Now, a court in New York, courts are limited to only considering a certain number of factors when evaluating a bail application. Those factors are defendant's ability to pay, the strength of the people's case, the likelihood of the defendant returning to court. Those are the big three. When I'm making bail applications, those are the big three I focus on. I think you can all guess what probably gets the most weight. So one thing you need to know is that in New York State, all criminal cases start out in what we call the local courts. Rochester City Court is a local court. All of these town and village courts are called local courts. In New York State, outside of all city courts, to be a judge in a town or local court, you don't need to be an attorney. You can be anybody, you just get elected to the office, you get a little bit of training, you go forth from there.
Except for city court.
All city courts, you must be an attorney in order to be a judge in those courts. And so they're allowed to consider those factors and bail set from there. Let me tell you what factors usually considered the least important in those, in my experience, and that is the defendant's ability to afford that bail. If a defense attorney feels that bail was set too high or not set at all for some reason and finds that problematic, you can appeal that bail decision to a county court judge. Since I started as a public defender here in Monroe County last May, I have not, in the local town court level, I have not seen a successful bail application for the reduction of bail. So bail. The couple things you should know. You can bond out on bail for about 10% of whatever the total bail is. However, most bail bondsmen, I would say all, but I want to be lawyerly about that. Most bail bondsmen will not work with anybody whose bail is less than $1,000, because that's 10%. They want an amount that they can work with. So, ironically, if you get a bail that's low enough that maybe somebody in your life could put, like, set at $250, and that's somebody in your family could scrape together a couple 20s and figure that out, a bail bondsman won't work with them. They have to come up with the whole $250. So often what we will do is we'll get people's bail set higher at $1,000 so they can get somebody, they can cobble together $100 and hopefully be able to bail out. I will tell you that bail decisions are usually made very quickly. The public defender's office operates a round-the-clock, 24 hours a day, on-call line. So basically, if someone's arrested at 3 a.m. in Monroe County and they're being arraigned in Fairport, they'll have a public defender there. Even if we don't represent them for the length of their case, we'll be there at arraignment to help them stay out of custody, essentially. And also deal if there's orders of protection issue, but to represent them at their arraignment. Those decisions are made very quickly. They're made very quickly at 2 p.m. They're made very quickly at 2 a.m. So that's bail. That's a little bit about bail in Monroe County. Speedy trial. Speedy trial is a little bit of a complicated issue if you're coming from the point of view of a public defender. So it obviously matters a lot more if somebody's in custody, because they're sitting there, like the horrible story of Khalif Browder, which is not unique at all. It obviously matters a lot more. However, if somebody's out of custody, it's good for a defense attorney to have time to be able to work and thoroughly investigate the case. Let me backtrack though. What lawyers call 30 speedy trials, 30-30 time. That's the number of the statute is 30-30. Some of the issues that are definitely addressed in the gaps on the governor's proposal speedy trial, some of the things you see are prosecutors announcing readiness for trial at arraignment. They have not interviewed anybody. All they have in front of them is the basic police reports we have, but they're ready for trial. So every adjournment that a defense attorney gets for their client is basically tolls 30-30 time. It's stopped. You will never I haven't heard of the DA's office having to eat time ever. I had a matter this afternoon with a plea that both I was in favor of and the judge was in favor of, but the people wanted more time. The ADA wanted more time to speak to a probation officer.
Right.
Guess who's eating that time? Not them, me, because they're ready for trial. So a couple of things. So speedy trial is important. It's important for people in custody. It's important that cases move apace. It's important that prosecutors be held responsible for delays they are causing, and not all of that time be always attributed to the defendant, because ready for trial is 9 times out of 10 an illusory statement. But right now that's not included. But I would ask that everybody kind of be cautious, because we see the effects of when cases move too fast. When cases move too fast, defense attorneys, specifically public defenders who have high caseloads, don't have time to properly investigate, and we won't have the time. If cases run on a 90-day schedule, you're gonna have a lot more guilty verdicts, because you're not gonna have public defenders who have enough time to do investigatory justice to all their cases. What's really important is that we address the illusory issues with the prosecutor, with ADAs. The next issue is discovery. What's discovery? So discovery is the evidence. Discovery is all the evidence that people have. I'm sure people have heard the case of Brady versus Maryland decided in 1963. It requires that prosecutors hand over all evidence, exculpatory evidence, to the defendant. However, in New York State, we have something that's that we colloquially refer to as trial by ambush. In New York State, prosecutors are not required to hand over key evidence like witness interviews until a jury's been selected.
Wow.
Can you imagine if you're, obviously in certain jurisdictions, it operates better than, sometimes you have DAs who hand over information ahead of time, they prepare, everybody is kind of trying to create the fairest environment possible, but there's no law requiring that. So, can you imagine trying to determine whether a plea offer is good when you're not entitled, you're probably not getting evidence, you're not entitled to that evidence until a jury selected. And that's a big, big issue when somebody's sitting in custody, and you're unable to kind of work with them enough to kind of get the information that you need to help investigate their case. And they're unable to participate in the investigation of their own case.
Y'all got that? You ready for law school now? So just to sort of really quickly recap, bail is something that functions to criminalize poor and working class people, that people with money don't ever sit in jail on bail. Somebody sets bail, they pay it, and they go home. Speedy trial, as Natalie was saying, one of the things that happens under our system, there's not a firm deadline about when you're entitled to a trial, and so cases can get endlessly adjourned by the prosecution, who the whole time is saying, I'm ready for trial, but is not actually ready for trial. And then finally, discovery. That people at the moment don't have access to the information that they need about their cases, and it makes it much easier for prosecutors to coerce plea deals. If you imagine sitting in jail on bail you can't afford, with no sense of when you might ever get to trial, and none of the evidence about your case, if a prosecutor says, I'll drop this down to a misdemeanor and give you time served, take this guilty plea, people will take it. Right, I get to go home tomorrow? You got it. Where do I put my name? So just to give you a sense of some of the kinds of decisions that people are forced into. So Caitlin, you've had an experience of bail in Monroe County. Will you tell us what happened and how it demonstrates the need for bail reform?
Hello, everyone. I'm Caitlin.
Hello.
I know now, I'll just start by saying this. I know now after meeting many women like Josie and women in the recovery community, very informed, strong, minded women, that my experience in Monroe County Jail was not right whatsoever, and that's just putting it lightly. I was arrested in 2014 and charged with petty larceny. I had no criminal record at that time. I was, however, struggling with my addiction to heroin. I was taken into custody. I wasn't given any paperwork. I went through a lot of feelings of confusion. I kind of felt like, what is even going on? There was no clarification on my rights to a speedy trial, access or information regarding what the public defender's case was, or I'm sorry, the DA's case was, and even who my public defender was, or if I had one. It was around 60 days later, I was put in front of the misdemeanor drug court judge, Jack Elliott, Monroe County City Court judge, and I then found out when his clerk said, would you like to keep her bail at 550, or would you like to change it to no bail, no release? No bail, no release is like a stipulation of drug court. I didn't know the whole time that I even had a bail, but Judge Elliott kind of has a way about him. So he said, almost like in an amused fashion in front of everybody, it seems to be doing the trick. I don't think anyone's coming for her, but just to follow protocol, let's change it to no bail, no release. So I ended up sitting in jail for 87 days until I went to a halfway house and signed a 1-year jail court contract. I sat in jail longer on pretrial than most people would sit if tried, convicted, of the crime of petty larceny itself.
So just to reinforce that for people, that is a $550 bail for a petty larceny charge, right? And this is a bail that lots of people, in Kaylin's case, didn't know was set, but for lots of people is out of reach, right? Or is a bail that requires you to put up next month's rent money. Right, and so then you don't have rent money for next month. So now you're in eviction proceedings with your landlord, right? So that kind of cascade of consequences of implicating people's financial lives in these decisions. Kaylin, I am gonna ask you one more question. Will you tell us a bit about the Monroe County Jail? So you sat in Monroe County Jail for 87 days pre-trial, so not convicted, legally innocent. And we keep referencing Khalif Browder. 2.5 years is a lot of time in jail, but 87 days is also a lot of time in jail. Can you tell us what were the consequences for you of being locked up pre-trial?
That I can do. So I've heard a lot of people refer to their time in jail or their experience in jail as humbling. I found it humiliating. I think Josie used the word dehumanizing, traumatizing. I felt confused. I felt worthless. I felt like the biggest scumbag. And I didn't have anybody telling me different. I remember my hair started falling out because the water there is so, like, you can almost smell the minerals and the sulfur and just the water pressure. I had like welts on my chest and my back. And I mean, you could fall and trip and your leg could be across the room, but you won't see a nurse for a week because you have to put in a sick call slip. So by the time they get around to it, you're used to carrying your leg around like it's, you know, like a handbag, you know? It's a lot of it was very absurd. I know Josie also touched on the men being on the floor, the deputies, like the way the bathrooms were set up. I remember there was a time where they thought that a weekender was bringing in contraband. So they brought dogs in and had us do, it was like an assembly line strip search. And it didn't matter if there was men deputy, men sergeants, women sergeants, we had to do it. I missed my son's third birthday being in jail. I had never been away from him prior to that. So when they say you're not the only person who suffers, that's very true. I opted to not have him visit me. I thought that it would do more harm than good to see me like that and just be confused. Like, why is mommy wearing that? You know, why is she just, you know, I always looked a certain way to him and like I wouldn't have been able to touch and hold him. So, I didn't see him for that amount of time. Prior to going there, I was screaming and begging for help with my drug addiction, and I kept getting told, there's no beds, or 30 to 45 day wait, stuff like that. So I guess in my family's eyes, at least I was safer. There's a misconception that jail is rehabilitating. I was on what's called the unsentenced side. So those of us that are kind of sitting and rotting, there's another side, the pinks. They get pink uniforms and they have programs and they can go to school. But the side that I was on, there was absolutely nothing. I saw girls get released and come back within the same week. I also saw girls get released and then I read in the paper that they died of an overdose less than 24 hours after leaving. So abstinence from drugs and alcohol, I could see how someone could call it that, but rehabilitating, absolutely not. I needed help, not jail, like most of the women I was there with. But after speaking with you yesterday, I guess that's what you get when a county puts more of their funds into the criminal justice system than healthcare reform. So.
And if folks were wondering about the fiscal breakdown of that, across New York State, we spend almost twice as much money on the jail system as we do on mental health. So if you add up all of the county expenditures related to jails and all of the county expenditures related to mental health, the jail costs are twice what we pay for mental health. Ricardo, you've also had an experience of bail in Monroe County and of doing 8 or 9 days pre-trial. And again, we want to be really clear with folks that that's not casual, right? That under the governor's proposed, and we'll get a little bit more into this, but under the governor's proposed legislation for bail reform, that people can sit in jail for 5 days pre-trial before there's sort of a real opportunity to challenge the bail that's been set for them. 5 days is not a casual amount of time. And so Ricardo, will you just tell us a little bit about what happened, sort of what was the circumstances of the bail and what were the consequences for you of those 8 or 9 days?
So this is back in 1971. My first encounter with the jail system, I had a petty larceny. I had stole, it might have been $67 or $87, something like that. Anyhow, when I got to the county jail, they gave me a $500 bail, which in 1971, probably really a lot of money compared to now. Probably like $2,500 bail. But for me, it was like a million. It was like a $1 million bail. If they had gave me a $100 bail, to be honest, I probably wouldn't have been able to get out. Maybe some people I could have borrowed it from, but if I could really borrow money, I wouldn't have been trying to steal money. And it really exposed me to the humiliating experience in there. I mean, it was, if you notice, I have a kind of a deep voice. It came from my throat being stretched. Me having to swallow my pride every 10 minutes in there, man. Being dehumanized. And I don't care what kind of man you think you are, you're going to get in line and just keep swallowing your pride. Because they running stuff in there. If they wasn't, I'd have told them, open this door, let me out now. Open it now. But they ain't going for that. So just to stay alive, because people are committing suicide and everything up in there, man. It's really bad for, and then they had me with people who did some other stuff. Should not have had us together. They should not have had me with them. I'm bad, I'm stealing. It's not good, but I ain't bad as some, I should not even been with people. They didn't separate anybody. The only person they separated back then, I don't know if they do that now, is if you were in there for child support. They kept you separate. Those were the only people, they called them, I think, civil prisoners. Other than that, you were mixed in with somebody who was in there, Jeffrey Dahmer's, for eating people and everything. You know, so it's built up. Then when you're like, after about 7 or 8 days, they call you back to court. I forget what the second appearance is. It's derailment, and then there's something else. And when they see that you can't make that $100 bail or $500 bail, and they're in there crowded, they'll let you go. They'll try to pre-trial you. If they ain't crowded, you in trouble. You in trouble. You're paid license or no paid license, you staying up in there because we got room for you. It's the system is built to keep feeding the system. That's what it's built for, man. And we have to do something different. And furthermore, the one thing that I do know, I done been to prison too, so I don't want you to think that it's just my first involvement was with that petty larceny. I have a big resume of experience with that, unfortunately. But the main thing is, it don't work. It ain't working. It ain't working. So we definitely got to advocate for something different. We really do.
So, Natalie, as a public defender, you've got a different vantage point for this. How have you seen the issues of bail and discovery come up in Monroe County? And if you can, will you highlight a case or two that illustrate how these issues come up?
Gladly. So one thing I want to point out is, I mentioned the public defenders and alcohol system, where we show up in person to defend people at arraignments 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. Christmas, Easter, New Year's, we're there. Well, I remember the first time I went on a felony arraignment. So the DA's office also has an on-call system. However, they only show up for felonies, and they're allowed to make a phone call to the judge to make their bail recommendations without ever having laid eyes on the person being accused of a crime, with only having seen, the paperwork in general. They're allowed to make they're allowed to phone in their bail recommendation, and the court will consider it. The court will consider it just like give it the same weight. I'm using that in air quotes for a reason, as they will my in person after interviewing and talking with this person and learning about their history and that. So that's something to keep in mind when we're talking about bail. But for a really kind of stark re-encounter with that happened just last week. I was on call last, I don't remember if it was Wednesday or Friday, I think it was Wednesday. And I went out to Greece on an arraignment. It was a guy who was currently between homes. I believe it was a petty larceny charge. He had some priors. He had a failure to appear, which is what it goes on your record when a bench warrant is issued. If you don't make a court date, often the judge will issue a bench warrant, and that goes on your criminal history report, which we colloquially call a NICIS, as a failure to appear. Guy had one. It's a petty larceny. It's a commercial petty larceny. It wasn't for like $500 or $900. It's for, you know, I want to say under $100. Food, I believe. And so I make this application to Judge in Greece, and you know, he's very low income, Your Honor. He's living in a homeless shelter at the moment. Like, you know, it's a commercial petty larceny. It's pretty low on the risk of, like, he's likely to go out and do something harmful to someone. Without even thinking. It was literally, I shut my mouth. A second later, it was $500 cash bond. Still happening. It's still happening. And it happens cavalierly. It happens like that. Because where I practice in the towns, you're not gonna find a judge of color. You're gonna find maybe one or two that I can think of, and feel free to correct me, Tom, that have ever, that aren't, you know, middle class, or, you know, who know anybody who has been through the system. They think of stays in jail as therapeutic. They think of it this way. They think of it as rehabilitative. You will hear this over and over again from city court on through the towns. And that's the experience of making bail apps, or trying to get people out of jail here. The cavalierness with which it's approached from the bench shocks me every single time. That said, you know, there are the judges who will listen. There are the judges, but typically that, you know, that is very far and few between. Discovery. So discovery is really interesting. Again, I don't practice violent felonies. I practice misdemeanors in the towns. And there's something called, what this is a little legally, BTRR. It's called a bench trial reserving rights. Not all courts allow these. Basically, usually what it's used is for rather low level, like assault threes, which is a main misdemeanor, it's not that low, but harassment seconds, which is a violation, but those kind of like interpersonal conflict crimes is what they're used for a lot. Basically, the court will set a date, and if the complaining witness doesn't show up, the case gets dismissed. Now, So, basically, the courts that allow this, it's really useful because the ADA will basically set down, they're showing their hand, they're saying, you know, we're not really, basically when that's set down, it's being, we have no contact with the complaining witness, we think they're kind of flaky, we're willing to let this, we're going to give this a chance, but we're going to get this, we're willing to get this dismissed if this person doesn't show up. In the courts where that's, and it's discretionary, the judges have total discretion whether they're going to allow that in their court. In the courts where that's not allowed, especially in these interpersonal crimes, basically the only way you're gonna find out what kind of hand the ADA is holding, you'll get some basic discovery, police reports, stuff like that, but it's basically just to wait it out. If you have someone in custody, you can't wait it out. Because nobody wants to sit in jail, so under legal duress, they're most likely going to accept a plea. But that's kind of it across the board. Here's another thing I'm seeing. We do a lot of DWIs. That's a big, big money maker for police departments. So you have a lot of people being arrested on it. Our police departments get a lot of grants for that. I have cases from September where I'm still waiting for blood results. But the people are ready. They're ready for trial on a DWAI drugs misdemeanor where the only evidence is going to be that blood, but they're ready. And I'm still, we're still waiting for that. I'm adjourning cases months and months. Luckily, these people are out of custody. Luckily, they're out of custody. But what?
You're in the Thomas too, though, so the defendants look different.
No, they don't. Not always. Not always. I'll give you, I have Parenton, so they do look different there. But in Greece, it's a really diverse crowd. So these are some of the issues you see in Monroe County. It's not good. The structure is broken.
Thanks, Natalie. So, Craig, as the executive director of the Pretrial Services Agency, you see the impact on people's lives of being incarcerated pre-trial, as part of your job is to get people home so that they are not incarcerated pre-trial. What consequences does it have for the outcomes of people's cases to be incarcerated pre-trial?
Well, before I answer that, I just wanted to say, if I can tell a quick little story. The reason why this is important to me and why I got into this business is simple. I'm going to be straightforward now. I'm a little white kid, maybe not little anymore, from the suburbs. And when I first came, started working in a pretrial, and I went into criminal justice, I wanted to help people. I didn't want to be a police officer. I didn't want to be locking people up. I got in Rochester City Court, and you just see the flow of defendants coming out. I remember leaning over to one of my coworkers when I first started, and I said, I don't understand why these people are in custody. An African-American guy, I work with, said, I don't know what you mean. He said, well, these defendants, and I'm not kidding, are in an open container. No seatbelt. There was young African American males in there. There was one, no bell on a bike. I didn't even know that was a law. Now they have been told overnight, but then some got released, pre-trial or on their own, but then some got help. And I said, I guess I just gotta get it. And he looked at me and he said, well, you're white. And I said, what do you mean? He said, you're white. He said, would you be arrested for that? And I said, no. No one would be arrested for that. But no, I don't think I'm gonna end up going to jail for having a beer on my porch or whatever. And like that kind of finally just clicked in my mind and said, wow, this is really not right. And whether it's Monroe County or the state or nationally, this country should be ashamed of the fact that we continue to incarcerate people that are indigent. They don't have the money to post back. They are predominantly minority. And for me, that's why I kind of got into pretrial services. I had a choice of other jobs, and that's why I stayed where I was. So our agency does the best to try to offset that, to try to make things as right as we can. It's not a perfect system. Our job in this county is to try to interview everyone who gets arrested, make recommendations, and hopefully judges, attorneys will advocate for those clients to be released. It doesn't always work. We interview probably about 11,000 people a year last year. We made recommendations on probably about 65-70% of those people, and only about half of the people that we interviewed got out. The other ones were held on some amount of bail. Could be for 1 day, 2 days, could be for 30, 40, 50. The consequences are monumental. Just being arrested is traumatizing. I haven't been arrested, but I can only assume. I've seen it for years. The traumatizing of that individual client taken off the street, taken away from their family, being brought down to the jail, being locked up. Then if they're held, there's a second piece that's traumatizing, the fact that you're not getting out. You've now been taking your liberties away, you're in custody. There's a third piece, is the family. The whole family gets pulled apart. Defendants are now in custody. Their family structure is broken apart, and anything good that that individual has going on in their lives, even if it's drug treatment, school, work, all that potentially ends unless they're out right away. And even if they get out with a day or two, or we get them out, there's still that obstacle in the sense that a lot of those benefits, a lot of those advantages and things that they've taken care of or been working on for their family are gone. Not all employers are going to hang on to somebody, even with a part-time job, if somebody disappears for a day or two and they're in custody. There are national studies that will show you that even people that are incarcerated 1 day are more likely to continue to be incarcerated if they don't get out right at arraignment. They can't work with you guys to defend themselves. They probably, because your caseloads can see you when they're in custody once a week, once every few weeks, because of the number of caseloads they have. Again, they lose their jobs, they lose benefits. So if people are on DSS or whatever, their benefits often are cut off if they're in there for any length of time. All these things end up with defendants who not only are released, they're more likely, the studies show, to be found guilty, and then also, unfortunately, to receive incarcerated sentences. So if somebody's held past arraignment, oftentimes that's what you're going to see. defendants don't get out, they'll be found guilty, or they plead. And it's horrible in this country that we have such a system where we have pleas constantly, because I want to go home to my wife, my kids. I'm probably not going to be in jail, but I'm going to still do it. I'm going to be like, yeah, I'll plead. I'm not guilty. I didn't do that. Or maybe I did something minor, but I'm going to plead guilty so I can get back to my family and my kids, try to go back to work or whatever. And also, like I said, oftentimes those defendants who remain in custody are not receiving probationary sentences or community service sentences. They're receiving incarcerative sentences. So there are all kinds of consequences, collateral consequences, to not only the defendant, but their family, when someone remains in custody for any length of time, even for more than 24 hours.
So, are we holding the question?
You are holding the questions. We may, Craig, I'm gonna, can we do this last question real
sure.
quick so we can get to questions?
Sorry.
So, no, y'all are great. So, ostensibly, bail is supposed to ensure return to court. That is what it is there for. All of the research, and Craig, I think this probably speaks to your experience, shows that there are some really good ways to ensure return to court. They're not bail. Craig, will you tell us about how you actually help people return to court?
And what stops people?
Well, let me preface what I'm about to say with, after Katie and I spoke and I read her little question on the sheet, I sat here and I was thinking, there's something really simple that we do to make people return to court, which is they just return to court. I don't have to have any magic pill to give people. We had over 5,000, almost 6,000 people released to our supervision last year. That could mean they're calling once a week. That could mean they're going to drug treatment, being referred to certain court conditions they have to follow, all the way up to electronic monitoring, which is practically jail anyways. 90% of those people return to court on their own. They will return. So that's kind of my answer, but besides that, what does our agency do? We provide support, referral. We try to figure out what roadblocks those defendants or the families may have to them returning to court, and then we try to address those with the defendant, like using needs-based assessments, things like that. Simple things we have found over the years, like call reminders, letters, texting them, just to remind them they have court. It's just support. New York City Criminal Justice Agency is the largest nonprofit pretrial in the state. They have a huge research arm that I wish I had, and we don't have here in Monroe County. They did a study where, believe it or not, a lot of defendants returned to court because they believed that someone was going to be in court for them. Not that they went to court and mom showed up or dad showed up. They just thought Katie was going to be there for them. So that's very telling of just human nature. You can't totally control human nature. Majority of people across the country do not abscond. They don't take off. They're still within the year. They didn't have a babysitter. They couldn't go to court. Talk about speedy trial, or you talk about discovery, or people being in custody, about being people out of custody, and their cases go 6 months, a year, for a $50 petty larceny at Walmart. They go to court 60 times. Attorney's not there. Judge is not there. It's adjourned. They didn't know. They got a babysitter. They got out of work. Sometimes our clients stop showing up because it's just crazy to continue to come back and come back and come back, not have a case taken care of. So that's what I would say is important for people to come back to court. Support, reminders, and most human nature, they'll come back on their own. I've proven that time and time again.
Transportation. Monroe County is awful to get around if you don't have a car. And a lot of people sitting in jail are sitting in jail because they don't have a license. Or they got that AUO1, which is aggravated license operation in the first degree, means you have a lot of suspensions, meaning you can't drive, and you're being held, or you're not being, you can't drive. It's impossible to get to Greece Court. It's off most bus routes. Most people can't get there. Most of my clients who don't show up to court because they cannot in any way get there short of walking and leaving, 8 hours before court starts. That's the biggest thing I see.
I agree. Transportation, housing. Transportation, there is ticket to ride, so there's a movement here. They're trying to do in Monroe County. I do have some county dollars in our budget where we can provide bus passes to clients and individuals. Our agency, we have pamphlets over there. If people are interested, we also have a free clothing closet in our office for anybody to come in. We have loans, supplies of food, we have clothing, toys, house goods. So we're trying to provide those things to the community. So really, it's just support. But transportation is a huge issue for the defendants to get around.
Y'all ready for questions? So we're going to, if the whole room has questions, we're not going to have time for them. After, so just to preview what else is going to happen tonight, We're going to take some questions, have some collective conversation. Then we're going to talk a little bit about the strategy to win, right? We don't just want to talk about how these systems impact people's lives, but we want to be really clear about how we are going to win change and conceivably win change in the next month. Stay tuned. And then we're going to provide folks some ways to step into action, that this is a really powerful first step. And there's some really exciting key things that are coming up around this. So just wanted to give a preview of what's going to happen. So Ashley, who's emceeing, is going to be questions monitor, and then we'll pass the microphone to folks. You're probably not going to have a mic because we only have one, so be loud.
Actually, Tim Donner, the public defender, is not here tonight, but him and I have been having meetings with various community members. That's something that we're trying to look into and have the county look into as a bail fund. They have been successfully used in New York City. I think you need to take a real good look at who's in our jails. Besides the bail fund, I do want to say that we just received a grant from the Division of Criminal Justice Services for additional staff members whose sole job at this point will be to go back into the jail for those who are held after arraignment on misdemeanor nonviolent felonies on bail. And their specific task is to try to identify what defendants are still in custody and do their best to try to get them released by going back to the courts, defense counsel, judges, and say, hey, Craig's still in here. They qualify for whatever level of release. They qualify for programs. And we have a plan for them. Can we release them? So besides the community bail funds being discussed, we do have a grant this 1 year, hopefully for the next 3 years. Like I said, they have additional staff to try to go in and try to do something about the defendants that don't get out right away.
Do it. Don't wait for the county. Give me a number so I can give my clients' families a number to call to help them get out of jail. Don't wait for the county. Get on it.
This, I imagine, is something that you know if you've been looking into this. Just important things for people to know. Community bail funds can only bail people out on bails under $2,000. There's some real limits on what community bail funds can do. I also might wait 1 month before you try to start a community bail fund because we might win the end of money bail, in which case you don't need it. So I might wait to the end of the legislative session before I try it.
As the governor's office talked about the bail reform too, I want to say one of the issues they did bring up is like, should we be letting the judges know like Craig has $500 and now we're all like now? Because then the judge is going to set $600 and they're going to set $500. So cash bail, cash bail should just go. We shouldn't use it at all. So we shouldn't need a community bail fund if people are just being released.
Yes.
So today
we did, and so we've been in conversation with Tim, and we're ready to do it. So
absolutely.
That's right. Work.
Yeah, so Simeon, one last response to that. I can't think of the lady's last name, but there was a lady who used to spend every day in the court system monitoring, recording the blatant racism that's going on. It's just lopsided. I don't have to go back to 1971. I just got arrested a couple years ago with Occupy. I got arrested, me and 15 others, 16 of us got arrested. Everybody was out by 10 o'clock except for me. All of a sudden, and I'm the only black person with my 16 that got arrested, but all of a sudden, we got to rethink this. And I'm talking about a civil charge. I ain't even talking about petty laws. I'm talking about just civil disobedience and the racism that involved. I didn't get out to about 1:30 that afternoon. Everybody else was out by 10 o'clock that morning. It's ridiculous. It's blatant. It's the elephant in the room. And we need to monitor it, record it, and put it back in their face. That's what I would like to see done, man. Get somebody to sit up in there and record the blatant just hypocrisy.
So I got a stacking one. So we're going to do this gentleman in the brown hat, and then we're going to do this lady over at the end table.
Okay. Hi, guys. So first of all, I want to applaud you all just for having the courage to speak about your personal experiences. have a question for Craig. So, as the executive of pretrial services, what would you rather see in besides incarceration? I actually experienced a situation at the city court where there was a young man who was released on pretrial services for rape. So instead of, I hear you guys all talk about incarceration, there, you know, you'd rather see something different. Can you give me some examples of other options other than incarceration?
Ultimately, I would like to say, I'll need a job from somebody, but ultimately I'd like to say I'd like to be out of a job. Because while I think this community will never get to a point where certain charges or defense that are charged with certain crimes will not end up in custody, it's not my opinion, I just think that's the way that it's going to be. I think there's a lot more options out there. The better use of ROR, which is release on your own recognizance, better use of pretrial services and the programs that we have available. You talk about the amount of dollars this county spends for the jail. Monitor somebody in the community, which we want to do in a safe way, and make sure that our ultimate goal is to return them to court. If we can, maybe plant some seeds and address some of the needs that the defendant has to help reduce their likelihood of coming back. Our programs cost not any more than $10 a day for monitoring, whereas the jail costs upwards of $150. If we want to be fair to the jail, it costs $60 a day for holding somebody in custody. So there's a lot of different options. I prefer not to see bail used. I think you're just continuing to punish someone if you use bail. So my ultimate goal would be I don't exist. Everybody's released their own word, they're released on their own, and they're required to come back to court to answer for the charges.
I also want to just highlight that this conversation does get complicated by the issue of overcharging. You have DAs and police officers, I see this, overcharging, no judgment on whatever that case was, but charging a crime they're probably not gonna be able to prove. So it looks more serious in arraignment, which has consequences for bail and all of those other things, and then it ends up petering out on the other side, but after someone's been sitting with this charge, this awful thing hanging over their head for months, whether they are or not incarcerated.
I'll say very quickly one final thing, which is we have to be really clear, even when somebody is charged with something scary, that they've only been charged, right? That if we're going to have any justice to our justice system, people are falsely arrested a lot, right? As Ricardo keeps very rightfully reminding us that the policing system is racist, that low-income communities, that communities of color are heavily over-policed, and we cannot equate being accused of something with being guilty of something. And we need to run our system.
What do we do about the mental health? They don't belong in prison. Do you guys have any programs, anything set up for them? Like the young lady last week with the East High incident, she's mental health. Do you guys have, I hear nothing in reference to mental health. What do we do about them? They don't belong in prison.
And maybe this is a question also that Josie could answer. If you want to.
Mental health is a big issue because 80% of the people that are in jail are mental health deficient. I mean, they're not getting the treatment that they should be getting. And I mentioned earlier the reasons why, but mental health is a big, big, big issue. People are getting locked up because they're sick. Not because they're criminals, they're sick, and they do things that ordinary people don't do, but that's not a reason to punish them, it's a reason to get them treatment, but our funds are going in the wrong direction. They're not going towards mental health care or rehabs or to these agencies that can actually help these people. They're going into the jail system, into the prison system, which is terrible because they're not getting the care that they need in jail or in prison. That's why Women's Initiative Supporting Health tries to go into the jail and recruit these ladies so we know as soon as they come out, we have the ability to get them into treatment as quickly as possible. So.
I can only speak from my own personal experience, but the first morning I woke up in jail, I looked around me, and there was a lot of young white women addicted to opiates or heroin sitting around me in jail. It's not what I expected to see in jail because of the media and just being informed on a bigger level. The life I had led, cops being racist and whatnot. I also think that being an addict in general is being part of a minority population who gets tossed into jails or prisons, like the people who need mental health help, like they're putting a Band-Aid on a bullet wound by just throwing us all in there and thinking that that's gonna make everything better. And as I shared when I spoke earlier, what I saw just from being there and then having been in the recovery world since, I don't think it's working.
You know, I have one question. When has trauma ever helped a mentally ill person?
Quickly answer, the simple answer to your question is that we don't have enough resources. We don't. As a service provider, we get someone released to us, they have mental health problems. My staff has so many roadblocks. We're trying to get them bed, get them treatment, trying to clear their insurance, trying to get them back on DSS, whatever the issues are, that we start from a corner and it's hard to get out of. They're slowly trying to do different things, but it's not enough. It's probably not quick enough. I know RPD is working with the Monroe County Health Department right now to try to have, they hired some mental health professionals that are going out on calls with officers. The officers can call them in, try to divert those defendants to a mental health facility or some other treatment rather than having them go into custody. So I know speaking with the sheriff and others within the community, it's a huge deal. I'm not sure any of us have answers, but you need dollars too. We can't keep putting dollars into radios and guns and police on the street. So.
And also, RPD is a pretty small microcosm of the wider criminal justice system of this county.
So we have time for one more question, but there's three people, and I couldn't choose. So we're gonna have each person ask their question, and then one person on the panel is gonna answer each question. So we'll start here and work our way to the back.
I have a fast question. Do you have a price comparison between ankle bracelets and incarceration?
Good question.
Cost.
Do you want to get all three?
Yeah, we'll get all three.
My question is, I do a lot of community building with alcohol and substance abuse across Western New York and Central New York. And what seems to be the running theme here is that there's an incarceration kind of coalition that's forming. Is there a process where all of these kind of coalitions and partnerships that are forming will be able to get together to really begin to discuss the issue? Because one of the things that we're doing is
So we are going to have Craig take the ankle bracelets question. Does anybody want to take the coalition's question? I can take that one. That's probably me. Okay, I'll take the coalition's question. And who wants to take how Monroe County is incentivized to keep it the way it is?
Who whole system is built.
Okay, we got it. Okay, Fred, will you give us some cost comparison around ankle bracelets, but also will you talk about what some of the dangers of a system that starts to move towards electronic monitoring is?
So one of the things we talk about in the criminal justice system is that lining. Our agency fights that. One of the things our agency fights all the time in the criminal justice system that we fight all the time is netlining. That's when a person who should just be ROR released on their own, for whatever reasons, the court puts them on a higher level of restrictive program. Costing, I can't give you specific costs, but as I said earlier, our lowest level of release, like pretrial release ROR, our clients just come in, check in with us, and make sure they go to court, $2 or $3 a day. Our highest level of release, which is intensive supervision, which include ankle bracelet, only costs about $9 or $10 a day. Versus the 60 if you want to use that limited cost, or up to $150 a day for a person being incarcerated in jail. Again, I would prefer not to go there. Even though our agency has electronic monitoring, we try not to recommend it very often. We always try to recommend the least restrictive means that will just ensure someone returns to the court. Because even as the governor changes his law here potentially, if it goes through, that there's a presumption of release, I'm worried then that the response from the courts or the DA's offices will be then everyone is on intensive supervision. So you're continuing to put people on levels of supervision that they may or may not necessarily need to be successful. So I would prefer that we not have to use things like electronic monitoring, et cetera, in our community.
Some of a couple of our directly impacted campaign leaders would kill me if I didn't say this, that ankle monitors are open air jails, that we do not want to create a system of mass community surveillance, and that is what ankle monitors do. And so we have to be really careful about being like, oh, well, we can let people out of jail, but, and I even hate the term ankle bracelets, that it feels deeply euphemistic. Bracelets are pretty. They're something that, like, your mom gave you for your birthday, right? What these are is
shackles,
right? They're electronic digital shackles. So I want us to be really careful about thinking that that's the solution. I will speak to the coalition's question really quickly, which is yes. She's not even looking at me. Trying to look here, make a connection. but yes, we do need to be building cross-movement coalitions, and we are in a lot of really powerful ways. So Free New York is engaged in what folks sometimes call pre-trial justice, right? So folks at the front end of the criminal justice system. A lot of our partners are folks who are doing police accountability work, right? How do we make sure that people are not being harassed or arrested or abused by police officers, right? We've got lots of partners who are doing anti-solitary confinement or anti-torture, or how do we get Pell Grants reinstated for people who are in prison, right? How do we change the conditions of people's lives who are currently incarcerated? And then we have lots of partners who are doing parole justice, or sort of the back end, right? How do we make sure that people are being released, that people who have done time are actually getting home at some point? How do we make sure that folks are not being released to parole and then reincarcerated for things like violating their curfew, right? Which is unbelievably common, that people are in jail on parole violations, on technical parole violations. Curfew, having marijuana in their urine, right? Low-level technical violations is a big part of the other set of people who are making up jails. So I agree, and that is part of that we need to be building really expansive visions of justice, really expansive visions of safety, and then really concretely figuring out how we partner. So just so folks know, there is a Free New York Rochester planning team that put on this event, all of the orgs who are co-sponsoring. If there are people in the room who are representing organizations who have not been part of that work, who are interested in the campaign and figuring out how we partner and signing on and being part of that planning team, there will be a moment to step into action. Please come find me or find somebody else who's part of the planning team to talk about that. So thank you for raising that. And then finally, this question of how is Monroe County incentivized to not do differently?
Okay, the incentive for that is, get up for that one. The incentive for that is fear, fear of losing stability, stopping these type of meetings, y'all coming together. There needs to be a whistleblower, an effective whistleblower system in place in this whole country. It's the only way we're gonna attack the corruption in the school system, in the police. All the police ain't bad, but the ones that ain't bad and say something, they gonna lose their job, their pension, and everything. Same thing with the teachers, same thing with the mental health workers. They see other mental health workers not doing their job, but they don't wanna say nothing because there's no protection for them. We need an effective whistleblower. The only thing that's gonna help tear this system down, man. And us coming together, more than just in these meetings. When we leave out of here, we need to get together because they got so many organizations. I don't think New York City might not have as many organizations as Rochester got, man. For real. But we don't come together, man. We gotta really come together and get an effective whistleblower system and take that police union down, that school teachers union, that mental health workers union. We got to tear all that down and get the corruption up out of here, man. That's what we got to do.
And I want to talk a little bit about how we change it. We are in a really exciting moment in New York State where we have the possibility in the next couple of months of fundamentally changing our pretrial system, of massively decarcerating our jails, of reducing the racial and economic disparities in our jail system. So let's talk for a second about how we do that, okay? So in order to get there, I want folks in this room to understand the kind of power that we have. So you saw for a second in the video, a year and a half ago, Just Leadership USA and partner organizations launched the Close Rikers campaign in New York City. When that campaign was launched, it was considered mockable to demand the closure of Rikers Island. People would and did laugh in your face for suggesting that we would win that. 11 months into that campaign, both the mayor of New York City and Governor Cuomo committed to closing Rikers Island. Now, there's still very much a fight to be had because Rikers has not been closed, but that's to say that we have some real power to shift the political dynamics, and we can't take for granted what is considered winnable at any moment, that we need to dream big and demand what we truly want, and that grassroots movements led by directly impacted people with a strategic vision really do and can win change. So let me start there. I'll give you a little bit of the background on Free New York. The campaign launched in the fall. 3 months later, the governor gave his State of the State address, in which he used a lot of the language that we've been collectively developing and pushing around this campaign, and mentioned all three of the demands, mentioned bail, speedy trial, and discovery. 2 weeks later, he gave his executive budget. So the governor gives a budget, that's the budget for New York State for the following year. In that, he put in legislative language for bail, speedy trial, and discovery. We have to claim that as a victory, right? That's an incredible victory. And also, as is often the case, the words were really good. The headline was really good. And what is in those policies is not good enough. Right? It is not bail reform that would get the kinds of decarceration that we would need, that would guarantee that people are not being held in jail pre-trial, that would end money bail. It is not a speedy trial reform that would guarantee that prosecutors aren't saying that they're ready for trial at the first court date. It is not a discovery system that would guarantee people access to the evidence they need. So what we need to do is fight this fight in the next couple of months, right? Does anybody know when the budget gets passed in New York State?
April
1st, if it's on time. We have between now and April 1st to push the governor and push the legislature to make those bills in the budget better. That means we could really win bail reform by April 1st, but we need to make sure that we hold them to the real standards of what we want. That if you pass crappy reform, you don't get another shot at it, right? So if the governor might get his headlines that he got a criminal justice reform victory, but if the legislation isn't good enough, if it doesn't meet the needs of individuals and communities who have been directly impacted by mass incarceration, it's not good enough, right? So this is our moment. This is our moment to demand real reform, okay? So I wanted to be clear about that. I want to be clear, governor's proposals aren't good enough. And when you hear DA saying like, oh, our office had ended cash bail, right? The Westchester DA announced that, the Brooklyn DA announced that. Also not good enough. You could drive trucks through the exceptions, right? The asterisks at the bottoms of those policies. Those policies only last also as long as that DA is in office, right? That is the DA saying, this is how I run my office while I'm in office. We need systemic change in Albany, right? That's the only way we really change these systems. So, who are the targets? Who gets us what we need?
Cuomo.
So Cuomo, Governor Cuomo is the big target from now through April 1st. We do, though, have a second shot at this. So if things don't pass, if we don't get what we need in the budget, does anybody know when the when the New York legislative session runs till?
June
20th. So we've introduced standalone bills. And so if we don't get it in the budget, we fight for it as a standalone bill. In that case, who's the target?
The assembly,
the Senate, right? We get to target those folks in Monroe County. Our folks in Buffalo are gonna target their people in Erie County, right? This is the value of having a statewide movement. So we have two shots at this to demand gold standard real reform. And this is the start of how we do that. So who wants to know how you step into action? Okay, great. So there are two things that I'm gonna ask folks to do. This is the first one, and you can do it right here. This is a postcard to Governor Cuomo telling him to do better. Functionally. So on the back of it, there's a place for you to write the county that you're in. So it's important that he know that this is a statewide demand, right? That we all know that jails are infecting communities across the state. So there's a space for you to say, I'm here in Monroe County. Then to explain a little bit about why you think we need bail, speedy trial, and discovery reform. And then sign your name at the bottom. They only look at things when they're connected to people. Otherwise, they act like we wrote all of them. So take a minute, do this. There's some pens on the tables. Folks have pens. You can do this right now and then leave it on the table. Okay, we're gonna deliver them to Cuomo in a giant, glorious statewide box. So you can leave it, and that way you also don't have to pay for postage, okay? So that's one thing. Do that right now. Also, isn't it pretty? We've got a great graphic design. Okay. Thing two. And this connects to the fabulous person back there who talked about coalition building, is that we need to have a very serious presence during budget negotiations, right? This is our April 1st deadline, both because we need to push Cuomo to make the bills and the budget better, but also because during the budget, bills can get negotiated and compromised into nonsense. Right? And so we need to make sure that Cuomo and the assembly understand that they need to make these bills better. They can't compromise them into making them worse, which is a very real risk during budget negotiations. So we are having a mass mobilization to Albany of folks who are dedicated to this campaign from across the state on March 14th. There will be a bus, free transportation, from Rochester. Y'all think we can get 50 people from Rochester to Albany on March 14th?